Thank you, Alice, so much. Good morning. Welcome, church, wherever you are, here in the parking lot, maybe around the world. Good to see you this morning. I'm Miss Karen. I'd like to give you a few announcements this morning, if you'll pull out this lovely, lovely orange piece of your bulletin. First thing on the list there is the school backpacks. They have been in the building for about a month now, but we've been trying to pay for them. And I just wanted to let you know today is the deadline if you want to make a donation for that. Also to let you know that we've reached our goal. So, yay! But if you still want to make a donation to that particular ministry, go right ahead. Next Sunday at the Hebron campus, they're not going to be meeting at the campus. They're going to be holding a baptism service at Matt and Kathy Jones's house. So there's a lot of information there about that. They have several people on the list who've been awaiting baptism, and with COVID, we've been kind of open and closed and open and closed. So they're going to do it in a swimming pool. So if you want to be a part of that, there's some information here. I would imagine get in touch with Jeff Poitras too, because they're asking that you carpool. But of course, with COVID, you'd need to carpool with people that you live with. Just saying, okay? Think about it, okay? Also, at the bottom are a whole bunch of listings about Sunday school classes. They're meeting all over the place, all over the week, in Zoom. You can be in person, you can be here, you can be there. So read through the list. If you haven't plugged into a Sunday school class, it's a great time to do it, because there's a lot of classes that have kind of merged together. So it's a great time to kind of plug in and meet some new people, but also to hear the word of the Lord and just do some teaching and preaching and hearing and learning and growing in the Bible study. I will mention too, let me throw that on the floor. Tuesday night, there's a church council meeting for any of you who are on the church council. That's at 7 o'clock, and it's going to be held via Zoom. And the church website, please go there. Lots and lots of things. I know I've been talking about Bible school a lot, but it's still going on. There are still people who are plugging into Bible school and doing Bible school. All of the lessons are out on the website. There's also, through Facebook, a link now to the picture video show that I put together for the pictures that folks sent me from what happened in their homes. And it's about 7 minutes long, but it is like the best 7 minutes of the week. So please take a few minutes, sit down and look through that and see what happened when Bible school went remote or went virtual and outside of the walls of Broadus. But let's go ahead and pray, and we can start our worship service this morning. Father, we've come here together to worship you. Some of us are in the building, some of us are in the cars, some of us are at our homes, but we're ready to read and study your word and to hear a message from you about grace. We thank you for knowing all about us, the good stuff and the bad stuff, and for loving us anyway. Thank you, God, for your mercy and your grace. Lord, today, start a fire in us this morning to grant forgiveness to those we need to forgive, not because they've asked for it or deserve it, but because that's what you do, and we want to be like you. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Good morning, Broadus family. I hope you're happy to be in the house of the Lord this morning. If you're out in your car, I hope you're happy to be out in your car. And if you're at home, I hope you're happy to be at home. This very first song is typically a song that is sung at the end of a service. It's more of a responsive, very slow. And Ellis kind of looked at me funny when I said, let's do it peppy. I said, because we need to celebrate the fact that even when things aren't going our way, and I think if I asked all of you, you would say 2020 is not going my way. You're one of the hard heads because you've decided, I am with Jesus no matter what. There is no turning back. Whether you made the decision when you were very, very young or when you were older, you said, I am going with God. Amen. Would you please stand and let's sing, I Have Decided to Follow Jesus.
Turning back, no turning back. Though none go with me, I still will follow. Though none go with me, well, I still will follow. Though none go with me, I still will follow. No turning back, no turning back. My cross I'll carry until I see Jesus. My cross I'll carry till I see Jesus. My cross I'll carry till I see Jesus. No turning back, no turning back. The world behind me, the cross before me. The world behind me, the cross before me. The world behind me, the cross before me. No turning back, no turning back.
Amen. You may be seated.
Good morning. Oh, should I do that? Okay. Is that better? Oh. Okay. Now the tax collectors and sinners were all gathering around to hear Jesus. But the Pharisees and the teachers of the law muttered, "This man welcomes sinners and eats with them." Then Jesus told them this parable. Suppose one of you has 100 sheep. Loses one of them. Doesn't he leave the 99 in the open country and go after the lost sheep until he finds it? And when he finds it, he joyfully puts it on his shoulders and goes home. Then he calls his friends and neighbors together, and they say, "Rejoice with me, I have found my lost sheep." I tell you that in the same way, there will be more rejoicing in heaven over one sinner who repents than over 99 righteous persons who do not need to repent.
Thank you, Kim, for sharing that passage with us. I want you to kind of store that away in the back of your mind for a few minutes, because we're going to come back to that concept of the grace of God that draws those who are lost. I know a lot of you are thinking this weekend and this Sunday morning, coming back into the church. We were inside, then we were outside, then we were inside, then we were outside, now we're inside again. You know, is there no stop to this? Well, this special occasion brought on by all the rain and the choppy fields and stuff out there, but we will be back at the picnic pavilion next Sunday morning, provided that we get a little relief from all the rain. But I'm glad to see you this morning. Now, last week I asked you to be considering some of the hardships that you have faced in these past 6 months, as we have faced the coronavirus and just kind of all the effects of it. And a few of you, and I appreciate the few of you who actually did respond. I got a handful of cards back, response cards that were put in the offering receptacles. What I want us to do this morning, as we consider, you know, what are some of the hardships being faced by our families, by our community, and our nation, we're going to lift those to the Lord. So in a spirit of prayer, I'm going to share some things with you and with the Lord together, and then give you a moment in your own silent prayer to God to kind of lift that and ask God to be working to meet those needs that we have in our hearts. I think that you will identify with most of these burdens that I share this morning. So I'm just going to ask that you go with me to the Lord in the spirit of prayer. Heavenly Father, we come to you because we know that you are the one who can meet our needs. You have blessed us in life with many people around us. Many different systems that help to meet our daily, especially our physical needs. But all these good gifts ultimately come from you. So, Lord, I do give you thanks for our family, our friends, for our church, for our community, for this nation in which we live, for the beauty of this world around us, for all these wonderful gifts. But, Lord, we know that this is a hard time. It's been hard for months now. And, Lord, on our hearts, and I want to say on most people's hearts, is the burden of just isolation, that we have times when we feel separated and are physically separated from our friends, sometimes even from our family members, from our church family. So many students who are separated from their regular school classes. Lord, we know that there are senior adults in our church, in our community, and just all around the world who are feeling very alone because they've not been able to get out or to receive the visits that they have in the past. Lord, even on Sunday morning, I think about the children who don't have Sunday school classes to come to. I think about the special occasions in our lives, birthdays and graduations, even funerals and weddings, when they're not able to be observed and to be in many cases celebrated as we have done in the past. And then, Lord, it even kind of sinks in our hearts sometimes that we miss a hug or the handshakes that we are used to or just the pats on the shoulder. And it's for a purpose now, we know, Lord, for safety. But we pray this morning and we take this morning, this moment to pray that you would meet the needs of our heart, that we would know of your presence, that we would be able to appreciate those around us, even when we're not able to be as physically close as we used to. And so, Lord, hear this prayer. And Heavenly Father, we also pray for the economic hardship that this virus has caused those around, maybe not in our own family, but maybe so. But there are people who have lost jobs. There are people who have been furloughed or they're underemployed and people just aren't getting out or even eating in the restaurants and stuff like they used to. And so, Lord, we pray in this moment for those who are struggling with that economic hardship and then just the uncertainty of the days ahead. Will those jobs still be here in the coming weeks and months? And so, Lord, for our own lives and others, we pray to you to bring stability, strength, and comfort during this time. And Lord, there is also the threat of the disease itself. There are some of us that maybe we don't even know anyone personally who has dealt with the disease or been in the disease. Maybe we don't know families who have lost loved ones, but Lord, they're all around us. And so I pray for these individuals, I pray for these families. Not just the physical disease itself, but also the anxiety that it causes. Just wondering, are we being exposed on any given day or any given outing? But Lord, help us not live with the spirit of fear, but rather to make sound judgment decisions. That we would be careful with our health and with the health of those around us without giving in to just the fear for the future, knowing that you hold the future. And Lord, we also acknowledge that we live in a very polarized nation and society, and in many ways even a world. And Lord, we've seen how even a disease that really ought to bring us together in some ways pulls people apart. And so, Lord, we pray that you would you would bring reconciliation, that there would not be a further division within our nation and our community, but rather we would come together knowing that as we face a crisis, we don't have to be alone. We've got one another, and most of all, we've got you. So, Lord, we pray that you would use this hardship to bring friendship, to bring a new sense of unity. And then, Lord, I pray for our church. Churches, just like schools, other businesses, it's hard to know the right way to function, the right way to reach out to people. And we know that our church is not alone in this. We are just like just all the others. There are some folks who are just not, it wouldn't be safe for them to come out and be around others. There are some folks who have really just kind of been on the fringe, and not to have the weekly services and Sunday school and the different meetings and dinners and all, then that's just kind of separated them from even their time of worship. But Lord, I pray that we might find the right ministries, that we might do them in the right way, so that people's needs would be met, so that they would hear the good news, the gospel message of Jesus Christ, and be drawn to him. Because, Lord, it is in the hard times of life that we realize more than any other that we need a Savior. Thank you for sending Jesus to us, that our anxieties can be laid at the foot of the cross, knowing that we have a Savior that loves us that much. I pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Power of sin and darkness, whose love is mighty and so much stronger, the King of glory, the King above all kings, who shakes the whole earth with holy thunder, who leaves us breathless in awe and wonder, the King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. You laid down your life. All that you've done for me. Who brings our chaos back into order? Who makes the orphan a son and daughter? The King of glory, the King of glory, who rules the nations with truth and justice, shines like the sun in all of its brilliance, the King of glory, the King above all kings. Yeah, this is amazing grace. This is unfailing love, that you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. You laid down your life. That I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me.
I'm going to come over here to Jamie's microphone. We got to get it shorter staff. That's what I'm thinking. There we go. That'll do all right. Max Lucado, most of you, that'll ring a bell. The author, in his book called No Wonder They Call Him Savior, tells this story. I'll share it with you here. It says, longing to leave her poor Brazilian neighborhood, Christina wanted to see the world. Discontent with a home having only a pallet on the floor, a wash basin, and a wood-burning stove, she dreamed of a better life in the city. One morning, she slipped away, breaking her mother's heart. Knowing what life on the streets would be like for her young, attractive daughter, Maria hurriedly packed to go find her. On her way to the bus stop, she entered a drugstore to get one last thing. Pictures. She sat in the booth, the photo booth, closed the curtain, and spent all she could on pictures of herself. With her purse full of small black and white photos, she boarded the next bus to Rio de Janeiro. Maria knew Christina had no way of earning money. She also knew that her daughter was too stubborn to give up. When pride meets hunger, a human will do things that were before unthinkable. Knowing this, Maria began her search. Bars, hotels, nightclubs, any place with the reputation for streetwalkers or prostitutes. She went to them all. And at each place, she left her picture. Taped on a bathroom mirror, tacked to a hotel bulletin board, fastened to a corner of a phone booth. And on the back of each photo, she wrote a note. It wasn't too long before both the money and the pictures ran out, and Maria had to go home. The weary mother wept as the bus began its long journey back to her small village. It was a few weeks later that young Christina descended the hotel stairs. Her young face was tired. Her brown eyes no longer danced with youth, but spoke of pain and fear. Her laughter was broken. Her dream had become a nightmare. 1,000 times over, she had longed to trade these countless beds for her secure little pallet. Yet the little village was, in too many ways, too far away. As she reached the bottom of the stairs, her eyes noticed a familiar face. She looked again, and there on the lobby mirror was a small picture of her mother. Christina's eyes burned and her throat tightened as she walked across the room and removed the small photo. Written on the back with it was this compelling invitation. Whatever you have done, whatever you have become, it doesn't matter. Please come home. And she did. This is a picture, folks, of grace. But many people simply don't understand the concept of grace. It often seems alien in our society. It has been said that when a person works an eight-hour day and receives a fair day's pay for his time, that is a wage. When a person competes with an opponent and receives a trophy for his performance, that is a prize. When a person receives appropriate recognition for his or her long-standing service or high achievements, that is an award. But when a person is not capable of earning a wage, can win no prize and deserves no award, yet receives such a gift anyway, that is a good picture of God's unmerited favor. This is what we mean when we talk about the grace of God. I want to talk to you about grace and the kingdom of God, as illustrated by the parables of Jesus. This has been our theme for the past few weeks. In the past 2 weeks, we've talked about the worth of the kingdom of God, and we've talked about the growth of the kingdom of God, Now we talk about its grace. Now it's interesting that Jesus is never once recorded using the word grace, which in the Greek is charis. We would transliterate it C-H-A-R-I-S. And yet, his gospel message, his good news message of the way God relates to us is an amazing picture of that which we have come to know as the grace of God. Now, a powerful lesson that Jesus teaches is that grace offers a home within the kingdom to those who are lost. The Gospel of Luke records three parables of lost things. You just heard a few moments ago, Kim, read the parable that we usually call the lost sheep from Luke 15. There's another little parable that follows right out after it called the lost coin. It says, and this is from Luke 15, starting at verse 8, "Or suppose a woman has 10 silver coins and loses one. Does she not light a lamp, sweep the house, and search carefully until she finds it? And when she finds it, she calls her friends and neighbors together and says, 'Rejoice with me, I have found my lost coin.' In the same way, I tell you, there is rejoicing in the presence of the angels of God over one sinner who repents." And then, of course, there is the third of those lost and found stories, the lost son. We usually call it the parable of the prodigal son. It's really about the loving father, isn't it? It's not such a different story than the one we just heard from Max Lucado about Christina and her mother Maria. It's a story of one who was lost, that young son in the man's family who goes off and wastes his inheritance and ruins his life, we say, and yet goes home realizing that he is really not worth even being a son in the family anymore, but he just wants to be part of that household as a worker. And the loving father welcomes him back in and throws a party. The one who was lost was found. Now, who are the lost? Well, we sometimes say it's those who are aimless in life, or those who are wayward and making bad decisions. Sometimes we use that word prodigal. We find them, these lost people, in prisons, of course, in halfway houses, in back alleys. But you and I both know we also find them in corner offices, at potluck dinners, in your neighbor's homes, and even often in our own homes. Some people who are lost, we would describe in our human judgment as being bad people. They are evil. But others are then just everyday folks. They're not out to hurt anyone, but they're simply missing something crucial from their lives. The lost are those who have never found the Savior. They still bear the guilt of their sins, and all of us have sinned. They do not yet have a hope of eternal life. We sometimes think of the lost as being those people, the kind we kind of roll our eyes at and shake our heads and look down our noses at. But lost is not a term of derision. In fact, in the New Testament, in the teachings of Jesus, lost is a term of endearment. Jesus loves those who do not yet know him. He loves those who are on the wrong path of life. He wants more than anything to find them and to be found by them. Jesus said that he came to seek and to save those who are lost. So it is that grace that offers a place in the kingdom to those who are lost. But then grace also offers a home within the kingdom to those who are unworthy. Now, to illustrate this point, since we're looking at the teachings of the parables during this series, Jesus told this rather strange and surprising parable. We usually call it the workers in the vineyard. And this is from Matthew chapter 20. And I'm going to read it for you. Matthew chapter 20, starting at the beginning of the chapter. Jesus is teaching here. So this is his quote. It says, "For the kingdom of heaven is like a landowner who went out early in the morning to hire men to work in his vineyard. He agreed to pay them a denarius," which was, by the way, just the average wage for a day's work. "He would pay them a denarius for the day, and he sent them into his vineyard. And at about the third hour," which would be about 9 o'clock, the early one starting at early in the morning, about 6, "the owner went out, and he saw others standing in the marketplace doing nothing, and he told them, 'You also go and work in my vineyard, and I will pay you whatever is right.' So they went. And when he went out again about the 6th hour or noon and the 9th hour and did the same thing, about the 11th hour he went out and found still others standing around. 5 o'clock in the afternoon. He asked them, 'Why have you been standing here all day doing nothing?' 'Because no one has hired us,' they answered. And he said to them, 'You also go and work in my vineyard.' Now when evening came, the owner of the vineyard said to his foreman, 'Call the workers and pay them their wages, beginning with the last ones hired and going on to the first.' The workers who were hired about the 11th hour came, and each received a denarius. So when those came who were hired first, they expected to receive more. But each one of them also received a denarius. And when they received it, they began to grumble against the landowner. 'These men who were hired last worked only 1 hour,' they said, 'and you have made them equal to us who have borne the burden of the work and the heat of the day.' But he answered one of them, 'Friend, I'm not being unfair to you. Didn't you agree to work for a denarius? Take your pay and go. I want to give the man who was hired last the same as I gave you. Don't I have the right to do what I want with my own money? Or are you envious because I am generous?' So the last will be first, and the first will be last." That rubs you the wrong way, doesn't it? It does me too. The complaint of these workers are, hey, how can you pay the same thing to the folks who worked 1 hour that you're paying to those of us who worked all day long? I'm going to tell you, it's the same basic complaint of the older son. I didn't mention him earlier, but the older son in the parable of the prodigal son. Because the older son says, this brother of mine doesn't deserve to be treated as a son like I do. Now, we see their point. Sometimes grace disturbs us. It is not our go-to response. But Jesus is not teaching how to run a business or a vineyard. He was teaching how God treats the children whom he loves. Thank goodness it's not based on merit. To those who will receive and respond to his grace with a heart of humility and faith, God offers the riches of his kingdom. But let me share with you another quick story about getting what isn't deserved. I don't remember all the details. I read this long, long ago, but it was kids at a park, and you know how kids in a park get together and they play, and so a group has gotten together and they're playing baseball, or maybe it was stickball, you know, and they'd gotten the teams together, and there's just one little kid, and he's kind of handicapped. He can't run as fast as the other kids. He can't throw like they throw. You know, he's kind of the one who always gets picked last or not picked at all. But he gets on a team, and the time comes for him to go up to bat. So the pitcher on the other team throws the ball across the base, and of course the kid can't hardly even lift the bat and doesn't get close to hitting the ball. But then the opposing pitcher comes forward and says, "Well, let's try this again." And he walks closer to home plate, and he tells the boy, "All right, the ball's going to go, you know, just right here, just give it a good swing, and he throws it in. Little boy misses again. So he said, all right, we're going to try it again. He throws it again. Strike three. But wait, that first pitch from back there really didn't count. You get another try. The third pitch, lo and behold, the little boy connects with the ball. Not well. It just kind of dribbles off his bat out into the field. But his team begins to yell, run! You know, run as fast as you can to first base. Little boy starts chugging along towards first base, and the pitcher casually makes his way in, picks up the ball, plenty of time to throw it to first base and making it out. He makes the throw, but my, it went over the first baseman's head out into right field. And so the team is yelling, well, go on to second base. And the boy turns the corner and he's heading to second base. And the right fielder begins to realize what's going on. He juggles the ball a little bit. And then he throws it over the second baseman's head, you know. And the shortstop has to go get it. The guy, little boy, turns and heads towards third base. The shortstop pretends like he can't catch up with him. And little boy turns, everybody saying, go for home, go for home. And so he's going for the home run, and the shortstop throws it to the catcher over his head out into the stands. It's a home run. Both teams come over and pick up this little boy, and they celebrate this home run. Did he deserve it? Nah, that day he didn't get what he deserved. He got what he needed. That's grace, folks. That we have a God who gives us not what we deserve, but what we need. Did the thief on the cross who asked for the mercy of God, did he deserve to go to heaven? No, he didn't deserve that. The world gave him what he deserved. They were putting him to death for his crimes. Jesus gave him what he needed, which was mercy and grace. So grace offers a home within the kingdom to the unworthy. Now the offer of grace, it has to be accepted in order to enter the kingdom of God. We have another parable about this. This one comes again from the Gospel of Luke, from the 14th chapter rather than the 15th. And it's called the parable of the great banquet. And it says this, starting at verse 15. When one of those at the table with him heard this, he said to Jesus, blessed is the man who will eat at the feast in the kingdom of God. And Jesus replied, a certain man was preparing a great banquet and invited many guests. At the time of the banquet, he sent his servant to tell those who had been invited, come, for everything is ready. But they all alike began to make excuses. The first said, I have just bought a field and I must go and see it. Please excuse me. Another said, I just bought 5 yoke of oxen and I'm on my way to try them out. Please excuse me. And still another said, I just got married, so I can't come. And the servant came back and reported this to his master. And then the owner of the house became angry and ordered his servant, go out quickly into the streets and alleys of the town and bring in the poor, the crippled, the blind, and the lame. Sir, the servant said, what you ordered has been done, but there's still room. And then the master told the servant, go out to the roads and the country lanes and make them come in so that my house will be full. I tell you, not one of those men who were invited will get a taste of my banquet. The lesson is you have to accept the invitation of grace. It's your responsibility to do that. You accept it by putting your faith in Christ Jesus. You stop making excuses that it's the wrong time or it's too inconvenient or it's going to cost you too much of your own, just taking care of yourself, that you would have to actually depend on God instead. You stop making those excuses and you trust the one who died for you and overcame the grave to offer eternal life. The Apostle Paul wrote, "For it is by grace you are saved through faith, and this is not of yourself. It is the gift of God." Faith is the channel through which we receive God's grace. Faith is our response. It's the acceptance of his gift. Now, if you think that you are so good that you don't need God's grace, you are really self-deluded. You don't understand the consequences of your own sin. You don't realize your own helplessness before a God who is pure and righteous. But if you think you are so bad that you could never be forgiven for what you've done, and your life could never be changed, then you don't understand the power of God's grace. It is sufficient for you. So here's my challenge for you today. Consider for a moment where you would be if it were not for the grace of God on which his kingdom is built. What would your life be like if you had to constantly wonder if you had done enough to earn your way into heaven? Imagine the despair when you realized you could never be good enough. But now let it sink in that God has been gracious and merciful to you. When you trust in him through his son, Jesus Christ, offering your life to the one who gave his life for you, the abundant and eternal life becomes yours. A gift of grace that no one can take away. If you've never received that grace, make the decision to do so today. Pray for God's forgiveness and his transforming power. And if you have accepted that grace, whether it was just a year ago or maybe 70 years ago, take a moment to express your gratitude to God. But then I would also ask you this: who do you know that needs some grace extended to them? Consider if God wants you to be the conduit of his mercy and grace, to show his kindness and to speak his message. Who have you had trouble forgiving? It's time that you do that, even if they hurt you deeply. Who could use your help, even if they have never offered to help you? To show them kindness is an act of grace. If you want to live in the kingdom of grace, remember that it only happens when you are willing to live by grace. As hard as it may be, it's worth it because grace has the power to transform your heart and to touch the heart of the other person as well. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for inviting us into your kingdom of grace. That's the only way we get there, is that you love us so much that you offer us a gift, a benefit that we don't deserve. We thank you for sending your son Jesus Christ into the world to live for us, to die for us, and then to live again, to rise from the grave, that we would know that there is hope beyond the grave, that you have offered to us an abundant and an eternal life. Lord, we thank you for that gift. And I just pray if there is anyone hearing this message today who has not accepted that gift, that your Spirit would work in their heart, that they wouldn't be able to let go of it, but rather that they would be drawn to you who loves them so much, the God who seeks and saves those of us who are lost. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. As we close our service, we're going to sing this hymn of response, and it's a response for each of us individually in our own hearts to God. But if there is a response that you want to share with me, I'm going to be here at the front. You're welcome to come talk to me, or you can make an appointment or call me or email me, and we will certainly talk about what the Lord is doing in your life. Carl?
Our hymn is Grace Greater Than Our Sin, and it was submitted as a favorite hymn by Shirley Tuning. And Shirley writes, "Grace that is greater than all my sins. It's hard to believe that God would do this for me. I liked it so much that when I was helping to plan my dad's funeral, I had it sung. And it still brings tears to my eyes every time I hear it." Would you stand with me as we sing? Father, we thank you for providing the grace that is greater than all our sin. And we know, Lord, that all we need to do is just say, "Yes, thank you, Lord. I accept it." Lord, as we go today, help us to graciously accept this grace from you. And as we go, may we tell others about your grace, your saving grace. In thy name we pray. Amen.